Hello anatomy friends, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we will really get into one of my all-time favorites, the knee joint. So our goals here will be to understand the different joints that fall under the category of the knee joint. It's actually three separate joints in this region. And we will of course talk through the many associated structures, so those ligaments, the tendons, the menisci in this region. As with all joints, we will discuss what movements occur at the knee joint, and it's a bit more complicated than just the typical flexion and extension. And lastly, we will pull in any clinical information and how that melds with the anatomy in this region. So which structures are commonly injured in unison, or which areas are more prone to injury. And if you think about it, you likely know someone who has had some form of issue regarding the knees. So either just generalized pain in the knees or a diagnosed injury. And this has a lot to do with the fact that the knee is relatively weak mechanically because of the incongruence of its articular surfaces. These surfaces are, I like this description, they're sometimes described as two comparatively large balls, which are the femoral condyles. So you have one here and you'll have one here. And these are sitting on what sometimes is described as like a warped tabletop, which means really just these relatively shallow tibial condyles. And these articulations between the femoral condyles and the tibial condyles will form the medial and the lateral tibiofemoral joints. And these two joints are really what creates that kind of hinge motion that we typically think of when we think of the knee. But also within the same articular capsule is the patellofemoral joint, excuse me. And this is where the patella or the kneecap, which has been reflected in this image, is going to articulate with the patellar surface of the femur. And so this joint formed by the patella and the femur is capable of very small sliding motions of the patella that occur in conjunction sometimes with the typical hinge motions of the tibiofemoral joints. So to reiterate, the knee joint is primarily a hinge joint, but you often hear it referred to as a modified hinge joint, and we will talk about why that is more in a moment. But first, let's focus in on the hinge motion. So here we're kind of looking at a lateral view of the knee region. And recall, a hinge joint moves in one plane. It allows flexion and extension. Now, like most joints of the body, flexion and extension at the knee joint occurs in the sagittal plane. But unlike most joints in the body, flexion does not move in an anterior direction in the knee joint. Instead, flexion will move the leg in a more posterior direction, reducing the angle at the knee joint. So it is moving, it moved the leg posteriorly, not anteriorly. Extension will be increasing the angle at the joint, and it's really kind of moving the leg back towards anatomical position. And you don't want it to go too far past anatomical position at the knee joint, so really avoiding overextension. So again, flexion is the leg moving posteriorly, and that is a key difference here at the knee joint. Now let's bring in the modified portion of the modified hinge joint concept. The knee joint is capable of small amounts of rotation as well. So whereas flexion and extension are the main movements, there is a small amount of medial and lateral rotation that's allowed at the knee. And these are small movements. Again, I keep saying small, but these are important movements. So when the knee is fully extended with the foot kind of planted on the ground, so say in standing, I'm just standing, I don't want to fall down, but I don't want to move any more than that. What the knee can do is kind of what's often referred to as lock in position. And it can lock in position with a slight medial rotation of the femoral condyles on the tibial condyles. Okay, so you have a little bit of medial rotation occurring there. And this slight medial rotation in the locking of the knee joints due to those condyles moving is often referred to as the screw home mechanism. And so you'll hear this brought up a few times. And this is important because it allows for the lower limb to really bear weight with this locked knee without forceful contraction of the muscles and without the knee joint stability decreasing. So it allows for the surrounding muscles to relax a bit during standing. You don't have to have forceful contraction constantly due to this slight bit of movement here. To unlock the knee, the popliteus muscle will contract, allowing slight lateral rotation, and this will allow for flexion of the knee joint to occur. So when you're ready to move again, you can unlock with a little bit of lateral rotation to allow flexion to occur. So slight medial and lateral rotation are important in maintenance, particularly in terms of medial rotation of an extended standing position without forceful contraction of surrounding muscles. Okay, both ligaments and muscles, as well as their tendons, play important roles in stability of the knee joint. And that needs to happen. You don't have a particularly good fit between the bones. But between ligaments and tendons, it is the muscles that are key here, although we will spend quite a bit of time discussing the ligaments as well because they are more prone to injury or damage. And many sports injuries are actually preventable through muscle conditioning. Of the muscles and their tendons, the most important are the quadriceps femoris muscles, and in particular, their distal tendon. So it's the quads that are key here. The patella, hope you recall, forms within this tendon. And the portion of the tendon, so here's the patella forming within, the portion of the tendon that extends from the patella down to the tibial tuberosity, which would be just deep to this, this portion right here is often referred to as the patellar ligament, but it's really just an extension of the tendon of the quadriceps femoris. It is this tendon complex that really is the anterior protection of the knee, as the articular capsule in this region is very thin and oftentimes incomplete. And as you might imagine, it'll also play an important role in maintaining the alignment of the patella. Okay, so let's get back into ligaments. So the ligaments that are outside of the articular capsule, even though one of these will actually be a thickening of the capsule. We just discussed the patellar ligament in the previous slide. So now let's focus in on the collateral ligaments. And like all collateral ligaments, these are found on the medial and lateral sides of the joint. And these will be taut, so kind of tight, when the knee is fully extended, but will slacken some with flexion and will also check rotation at the knee joint to prevent over-rotation. The fibular, often referred to as the lateral as well, so the fibular or lateral collateral ligament is, as you might imagine, lateral, so it's going to play a role in protecting that lateral side. It is completely extrinsic, meaning it is not a thickening of the articular capsule. So it's completely separate from the articular capsule, and it is shaded here in yellow. So over here on the lateral side, on the same side as the fibula. On the opposite side is the tibial or medial collateral ligament. Now, this ligament is a thickening of the articular capsule. So it looks like a thickened portion of the articular capsule. And it tends to be the weaker of the two between the two collateral ligaments. And this is important, so I hope you put lots of little stars next to it. It is actually attached to the medial meniscus. This attachment between the TCL-MCL and the medial meniscus is an important one because if one gets damaged or injured, it is likely that the other will as well. And you can see this over here that is highlighted in orange. Now moving deeper into the articular cavity of the knee joint, and you will find two relatively short ligaments crisscrossing one another. So you can see them crisscrossing right here. And these are the cruciate ligaments. That's where they're getting their name from, the crisscrossing. The point where these cross serves as the pivot for the rotary or the rotation movements and will limit the amount of rotation possible. So let's talk about each one of these. And we will start with the anterior cruciate ligament for two reasons. First, it's anterior. We like to start anterior. And second, you've likely heard of the ACL as it's one of the more commonly injured ligaments. The ACL will arise from the anterior intercondylar area of the tibia and will attach to the lateral condyle of the femur, and it will prevent the tibial anterior displacement, meaning it will not let the tibia move too far forward. Additionally, it will also prevent femoral posterior displacement, so it will not allow the femur to be displaced posteriorly. So when the joint is flexed, the tibia cannot be pulled anteriorly, like it cannot be pulled out like a drawer, because it is held in place by the ACL. If it does move too far anteriorly, then that is known as the anterior drawer sign, meaning there's likely an issue with the ACL. So not a good thing there. You do not want that tibia to be able to go too far anteriorly. The ACL is the weaker of the two cruciate ligaments and more prone to injury, sprains, or damage. The posterior cruciate ligament is the stronger of the two. So if anterior is the weaker of the two, then you have to have a stronger one, and that is the PCL. And this ligament kind of does the opposite of what the ACL does. It will help prevent tibial posterior displacement or femoral anterior displacement. So if there's too much posterior tibial displacement allowed, this would indicate that there is likely damage to the PCL. So those drawer tests are really testing whether the tibia moves too far anteriorly or too far posteriorly. In the weight-bearing flexed knee, such as when you're walking downhill or stairs, the PCL is hugely important in stabilization of the femur. Okay, and we can't talk about the knee joint without discussing the menisci. So menisci is plural, meniscus is singular. Recall that menisci are fibrocartilaginous plates shaped similar to crescents. So they're not completely encircling the tibial condyles. They're more of a crescent shape. And again, these are located on the tibial condyles. They're kind of sitting right on those tibial condyles and serve to kind of deepen that articular surface to allow for a slightly better fit between the bones. It will also play a role in terms of shock absorption. Again, we mentioned this before, the medial meniscus is going to be firmly attached, you can see that here, to the tibial or medial collateral ligament. So I brought that up, that connection, a few times, that attachment between the medial meniscus and the tibial collateral ligament a few times, so make sure to find some space in your memory for that anatomical relationship. So you can see the middle meniscus here in green and the lateral meniscus here in light blue. And before we finish up, let's discuss a specific clinical consideration, and you will get much more clinical guidance in this area in the knee clinical lecture. But this injury of three anatomical structures called the unhappy or terrible triad, and that sounds awful, right? This is often brought up on board exams, so I want to mention it here. So the three anatomical structures include the anterior cruciate ligament, or ACL, which makes sense. I said that the ACL is the weaker of the two cruciate ligaments, as well as the medial meniscus and tibial or medial collateral ligament, which makes sense that these two structures would be injured together as they are attached to one another. This type of injury is more common in contact sports. So if you think of somebody tackling or hitting you on the lateral side of the extended knee, So you have a blow, say, to this lateral side. That force will kind of travel through and disrupt the tibial collateral ligament, which will typically tear or even detach the medial meniscus. And just due to the inherent weakness of the ACL with a powerful blow, this is commonly injured as well. Can you have injury to just one of these structures? You most absolutely can, but just how the knee is organized, it's not uncommon for these three structures to be injured at the same time. All right, excellent. We have made our way to the summary slide. So much going on here, but the knee joint is one of the more common places for MSK complaints, so it is important we get our bearings regarding the anatomy of this area. Please take time to review, and as always, I hope you reach out if you have any questions or clarifications. Thanks for your time and attention.